السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. Welcome to a live session of Ask an Imam. My name is Farhan Iqbal, and this is a live program where you can ask any questions about Islam, about the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, about other world religions, and answers are provided in light of resources found on the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, that is www.alislam.org. A-L-I-S-L-A-M.org is the official website of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. You're watching this program on multiple platforms. That includes Twitter, Facebook, and YouTube. On any of these platforms, you can join the conversation today. It could be about the topic that is being discussed today, or any other question that is related to Islam. This is an Ask an Imam, which you can ask. On Twitter, you can use a live stream itself to give your comments. On Facebook, you can use a comment section. And on YouTube, you can use the live chat to be part of this conversation. As I mentioned, my name is Farhan Iqbal, and I am a missionary of the Ahmadiyya Muslim community. Today, I would like to tell you why you should read this book, The Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam, that has been written by Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad, peace be upon him, the Promised Messiah and Imam Mahdi. This book is available for your reading from alislam.org. All you have to do is on alislam in the search bar, type the philosophy of the teachings of Islam, and the very first link is the PDF link. The second link is going to take you to a page which briefly introduces the book and gives you the option to download or obtain the book in these multiple formats. So you can see it is available in the browser format, in PDF, on Apple Books, on Google Play, Google Books, Amazon Kindle, as a study guide, and also as an audiobook. So any of these services that you feel most comfortable with, you can use to obtain your copy for free of the book, The Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam. What is this book about? And that is what I wanted to talk a little bit about today. This book is basically, the background to this book is that a person by the name of Swami Sadhu Shugan Chandar had spent 3 or 4 years of his life attempting to reform his Hindu caste. And in 1892, he decided that there should be a conference where people can come together and assess the faiths of different people. And so he held this religious conference. The first one took place in 1892 in Ajmer. And in 1896, he considered Lahore to be a suitable venue for this religious conference. And so what he did is he appointed a committee to oversee the arrangements, and different people were involved, and eventually it was decided that it would be held on 26 to 28 December 1896. And there were 6 members that were selected as the moderators for this conference. They decided upon a location. They called it the Conference of Great Religions. They sent invitations to different people, different religious leaders. And they said that each of the speakers who will come to speak on the assigned topic should confine his answers to the holy book of his religion. And the questions that they decided would be the discussion points. Number one, the physical, moral, and spiritual states of man. Number two, what is the state of man after death, that is the hereafter? Number three, what is the true purpose of man's existence on earth and how can it be achieved? Number four, what are the effects of one's deeds in this life and in the afterlife? And number five, what are the sources of divine knowledge? So this conference, which was held on 26 to 29 December, had all these representatives, and of course, the representative from the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, the one who read out the paper, was Maulvi Abdul Karim Sahib Sialkoti radhiyallahu anhu. But the lecture that he was reading was basically written by the Promised Messiah, Hazrat Mirza Ghulam Ahmad alayhi salam. And this book, The Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam, is basically the transcript of that lecture that was read out at that occasion. So it's a very interesting book, and I encourage all of you to have a look at this book, to read this book in any of these formats that are available on alislam.org. This is an Ask an Imam, where you can ask any questions about Islam, about the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, about other world religions, and answers are provided in light of resources that are found on alislam.org. You can ask your questions basically about this topic that I've selected for today, or on any related faith matter, answers, as I have mentioned, are usually provided in light of the resources that are available, that are found on alislam.org, alislam.org. It's a wonderful website that has many resources that you can use. I have talked today about this book, The Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam. In fact, we have had the Ask an Imam program that at least I have been part of. It has been going on before as well, but I have been part of it for 2 years now. And one of the most common questions that we get asked about is about the afterlife. In fact, even I remember that being at any stall, a bookstall, where we preach our faith, one of the most common questions that people ask about is life after death. And every time we say that, we tell people about this book, which talks about life after death and clarifies this topic to a great extent, which is a topic that many people are interested in. Similarly, the most fundamental religious question is, what is the purpose of a human being's existence, right? And that is also one of the questions that is discussed in this book. So that's why we should read this book if we have not yet read this book, and try to benefit from all the different topics that are discussed in it. As I mentioned before, this is an Ask an Imam, where you can ask any questions about Islam, about the Ahmadiyya Muslim community, about other world religions, and answers are provided in light of resources that are available on the website alislam.org. Zishan has asked that, is it true that if a person swears, then a scorpion is in that person's grave, or what is the punishment of swearing or abusing? I'm not sure where you are getting this from. Sometimes there are some superstitious beliefs. I'm not saying that this is, but sometimes these are just things people say, and they get passed around, and some people come to believe in them. But the reality is that when it comes to sin and good deeds, the true reward or punishment for those things is with Allah. So it is up to Allah how He rewards His chosen servants and how He punishes those who violate His laws or His teachings. And for us to say that this is going to happen in the grave, you know, that itself, has anyone seen something like that happening in a person's grave? That this is how such a person is tormented? Even those things that are mentioned in Ahadith, and the Quran itself also states that even though there are some descriptions of paradise and hell in the Quran, those are academic descriptions. Those are descriptions that are meant to convey a message. They're not meant to be taken literally, because the Quran itself says that no soul knows. فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسُ مَا أُفِيَ مِنْ كُرَةِ أَعْيُنٍ. No soul knows what is hidden from the delight of the eyes in the hereafter, right? So no one knows exactly what we would experience while in paradise. And this is, again, a topic that is discussed in the book that I was just talking about, The Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam. Similarly, when it comes to punishment also, we are given some descriptions in the Quran, in the Ahadith. But again, the Quran says that no one knows. And the Hadith also says, no eye has seen, no ear has heard, no heart has even imagined what it would be like in paradise. Right? So the true nature of those things are not known to us. We know them academically, that one is a place of pleasure and comfort and peace, and the other is a place of torment and trial, or you can say punishment. So that the true nature of those things are left to God alone. And only when a person gets to those places, he would know, or he or she would know, what the experience is like. So if it is stated that a person, if you swear and this is going to happen, yes, if you swear in a way that is bad, if you're using bad language, then it is a form of sin. So instead of worrying about the true nature of the punishment, what we should be worried about is the wrath of Allah. As we are taught in Surah Fatiha, اِهْدِنَا سِرَاطُ الْمُسْتَقِيمُ سِرَاطَ الَّذِينَ أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيْهِمْ. Guide us to the right path, the path of those upon whom you have bestowed your blessings. غَيْرِ الْمَغْزُوبِ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا الضَّالِينَ. Not of those who have incurred your displeasure, nor of those who have gone astray. So we are asking Allah that we don't want Him to be displeased with us. We are looking for the pleasure of Allah. So that should be our mindset and our goal, that we are looking for the pleasure of Allah and for His rewards, and we are not looking to do anything that displeases Him. And if we do mistakenly do something that displeases Him, then Allah says that He is a Ghafoor, He is Rahim, He is the merciful, He is the forgiving. So we should turn towards Him in repentance, turn towards Him with the istighfar, right? Which is seeking forgiveness for our sins. When we seek forgiveness for our sins, then Allah has promised forgiveness, right? Because human beings, we are weak and we can be tempted or we can slip. And that is why Allah has given us this option to always keep on repenting and seeking forgiveness in humility, right? And He has promised rewards and He has promised forgiveness as a result of that. This is what we have been taught in the Holy Quran. This is what we see the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam also emphasizing, right? And even showing us by his own practice, right? Of course, the istighfar or the forgiveness that the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the way he did it, it was a different form of istighfar or seeking forgiveness. But the idea is that human beings are weak. And even for future sins, if we keep on doing istighfar, and this is again another point that is mentioned in the book, The Philosophy of the Teachings of Islam, that on a daily basis, we should be seeking forgiveness of Allah. And that is important. Okay? Right? So if a person swears, then what he should be worried, not about a scorpion coming in the grave, but more about what kind of, whether he is displeasing Allah or not. That should be his concern. One question that has been asked is, if Fajr is at 4:45, till what time is it best to perform Tahajjud prayer? So the calculation for Tahajjud prayer should come from the time of sunrise. Nowadays, it is very easy. On most phones, even you can check the sunrise and sunset times. On you can easily search this on Google as well. And if the Fajr time is 4:45, then that means that usually 1 hour and 10 minutes or 1 hour and 15 minutes later is the sunrise. But it is better to check, right? So let's say sunrise is at 6 o'clock, right? If sunrise is at 6 o'clock, then Fajr time would begin at 4:45, or you can say 4:40, because it's usually about 1 hour 20 minutes or 1 hour 18 minutes, when the breaking of dawn occurs, and about 5 minutes later we offer Fajr prayers, right? So given that, what happens is that tahajjud prayer should be offered 90 minutes before sunrise. I've seen Hazrat Khalifatul Masih V, may Allah be his helper, has mentioned that tahajjud prayer should be offered 90 minutes before sunrise. And so if sunrise is 6 o'clock, then tahajjud prayer can be offered up to 4:30. So you can wake up at 4 o'clock and offer tahajjud prayer, or, up until 4:30. And then you have some time, maybe you can read the Quran, and then it would be Fajr time. And if a mosque is nearby, you can go to the mosque and offer the prayer and that way, because it gives you that space to even, drive to the mosque if you have to. So that's how it is to be calculated when it comes to tahajjud time. Kindly explain about the acceptance of prayer in tahajjud prayer. Now, this is a short program, so it's not possible for me to go into all the details. But if you want to learn more about tahajjud prayer, there are some Friday sermons of Hazrat Khalifatul Masih V, may Allah be his helper, where he has talked about this. So if you just type in tahajjud prayer, right, there are some fiqh matters that are related, but Remembrance of Allah, that's one book that actually talks about tahajjud a lot. And so you can read from there. You can try different searches that are related. Acceptance of prayers would definitely yield a lot of results. Actually, this book, Conditions of Ba'ath. The Conditions of Ba'ath, but there is another book, Conditions of Ba'ath and Responsibilities of an Ahmadi. Responsibilities of an Ahmadi. It's a wonderful book that discusses tahajjud. So you can go and scroll down to this part, Be Regular in Tahajjud. This is page 57. You can find some material on related to the offering of tahajjud prayer. Basically, in the hadith, it is stated that Allah descends down to the lowest heaven at the time, in the third part of the night, right? After two-thirds of the night have passed, in the third part of the night, Allah descends to the lowest heaven. And of course, this is metaphorical language that is meant to say that that is the time when Allah listens most to prayers. So acceptance of prayers is the highest at that time. So we should be offering tahajjud prayer at that time. Tahajjud prayer is basically nafal prayer, which is voluntary prayers. If we offer voluntary prayers at that time, that is the time that is best for the acceptance of prayers. And that's why tahajjud is emphasized. Even in the conditions of Ba'ath, we are taught that we should be regular in tahajjud prayer. So every one of us should be offering tahajjud prayer the best we can. And similarly, you can find some of these resources on Al-Islam about tahajjud. There's in fact one more before I go to the next question. There's one more I wanted to mention, one more resource, and that is the book Gardens of the Righteous. Gardens of the Righteous is the English translation of the book Riyazus Salihin. And in this book, if you scroll down to the index, there's a section on tahajjud prayer that you can find, and you can learn more, and you can read those ahadith directly from there if you're looking for more information on this topic. Okay. The other thing about tahajjud is that it is, when it is offered at that time, it's a quiet time, it's a peaceful time. You have sacrificed sleep to get up at that time. So that's why, because a person has to put in that extra effort, that also means that Allah will respond to it, right? And because we are making that extraordinary effort, right? And Allah is Rahim, He's merciful, He turns towards those who make even a little bit of effort. So as it is stated in another hadith, that even if you walk towards Allah, He will come to you running. So that kind of effort made at tahajjud is very rewarding, and it's very beneficial. What is the Ahmadiyya perspective on jinn? So when it comes to the to jinn, this is a topic you can easily find many answers to this, many discussions on this on alislam.org. If you just type in the word jinn, and I will show that to you in a second. But for some food for thought, the word jinn in Arabic comes from a root which means to cover something. The word Jannah is also from that root, because it is covered and hidden from us, right? So anything that is hidden in that way can be considered or can be called jinn. And when we study the usage of this term in the different parts of the Holy Quran, of course, it is at one place it says that Satan was among the jinn, right? Satan is among the jinn. And again, that is also because Satan is not physically visible to us. He is hidden from us. That's why he is also considered one of the jinn. Then in one place, the discussion in the Quran, the context shows us that the word jinn is referring to a nation that is hidden from people, right? People that are hidden from others, or that live in a very private way, they are also considered jinn. There is also in one place the discussion leads us to believe that it is a reference to bacteria or germs that are hidden from us, but it's very important to know about them, because as we are in the pandemic also, how dangerous they can be, right? So these are different meanings, but if you are looking for a detailed, comprehensive answer to this question, what I suggest is you go to alislam.org and type in jinn. You will get some results. So there is this discussion of jinn in this book, Revelation, Rationality, Knowledge and Truth. One entire chapter is dedicated to this topic. Similarly, there is discussion of jinn on Al-Islam. If you go to the main page and click on Ask Islam and then type in jinn here in the search term, there are some discussion answers to the concept of jinn, right, that you can benefit from here. All right. Okay. How can one prove that the Bible has been changed by humans to a Christian? One of the ways to prove that the Bible is a work of human beings and those human beings have possibly made mistakes is to, for a Christian especially, is to read the gospel accounts about Jesus Christ that are parallel to one another. A lot of times what happens is that when people are reading the Bible or the Gospels, they read the Gospel of Matthew, and then they read the Gospel of Mark, and then they read the Gospel of Luke, and then they read the Gospel of John, right? So they are reading it one book after another, and so when they read something in Matthew and then they come across the same story in Mark, they find the stories to be similar and they move on. But if you analytically look at each one of those stories closely, you will see that there are some clear differences in those stories. For instance, the baptism of Jesus Christ is a very famous story, that Jesus Christ was baptized by John the Baptist, right? One of the reasons why John the Baptist, he's called the Baptist, is because he is known to have baptized Jesus. Now, in the Gospel of Matthew, I believe that baptism is the verse is not in front of me, but it is mentioned. But if you go and look at the Gospel of John, the interaction between John the Baptist and Jesus is a completely different interaction, and there is no baptism, right? So similarly, there are many, many examples of this, right? And just yesterday, I was reading one story that occurred at Bethany, where Jesus Christ is anointed by a woman. Now, in the Gospel of Mark, the one who is anointing him with an oil is a woman, is mentioned as, simply as a woman. No name is mentioned. And then in the other Gospels, in the Gospel of John, it's specifically mentioned that that woman was Mary. And then it says that some men criticized Jesus. In the Gospel of John, it says it was Judas Iscariot who criticized Jesus. So who criticized Jesus? Was it some men or was it Judas Iscariot? Right? Because the Gospel of Mark gives us the impression that these were probably opponents of Jesus, or, you know, these were not disciples who made this remark. Similarly, what are the last words of Jesus? When Jesus was on the cross, the Gospel of Mark tells us that he said, "Eli, Eli, lima sabachthani? Oh my Lord, why have you forsaken me?" In the Gospel of Luke, the last words are, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do." Completely different phrase. In the Gospel of John, also different. So which one is it? Well, did Jesus say this or did Jesus say that? Then when supposedly on Sunday, when Jesus is you know, from our perspective, he was healed and he had recovered from his wounds, you know, who was the first to see Jesus, right? And how many women were there who saw Jesus? So there are lots of discrepancies. I've just given you a few examples from off the top of my head, but if you're looking for more, you can definitely reach out and I can share some more examples of this. But these are some of the examples to consider when it comes to these, you know, showing them that the Bible, you don't have to argue that the Bible has been changed. What you have to argue is that the Bible is a human account. Yes, there are some revelations of Jesus that you find here and there, but most of the accounts are written by human beings. So we cannot give the Bible the same status as we give the Quran. The Quran is entirely word to word, the word of God. The Bible is the words of human beings who have made mistakes, who are just giving us historical accounts. And here and there, we do find some revelations of Jesus Christ, right? But those are very few, right? So that's what you should be arguing when it comes to comparison of the Bible and the Quran. Why are physical pleasures easier to obtain than spiritual ones? Why can God not show some of the spiritual pleasures to a person who tries to improve so that he has a motivation? Well, the answer to this question is that this life, Allah says, is a test for us, right? لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ. He says that it is there so that he may try you, which one of you is going to act better than others. The way Allah has created this world is so that we have an option between good and evil. And those who choose good, despite the availability of evil, despite the ease of evil, they are promised great rewards. But many of those rewards are hidden from us. And they require some effort to obtain, right? And if those pleasures, as you have mentioned, if they were all readily available, those spiritual pleasures, then everybody would have believed. Then there would have been no test. Then we would not actually be human beings anymore. We would be like the angels who just do what they're told to do, and they are acting upon the commandments of Allah. So being human itself, where we have the free will, the choice between good and evil, requires that we have access to both. And in fact, even worldly pleasures are not that easy to obtain. Think about it. Those people who pursue the world, you know, they get into so many different kinds of problems. You know, we have, what are the pleasures of this life? There are nowadays, there's a lot of discussion about drug consumption. Now look at those people who are drug addicts or who are into these things, they suffer, many of them, the consequences. They have a great risk to their life. There is an overdose problem. Many people die from drug overdoses on a regular basis, on a daily basis. So there are pleasures and difficulties in both. You said that why is the pleasure not so easily available? I believe that it is. I believe that walking into a mosque and offering a prayer there, even physically, it is a very calming and meditative experience because you are not distracted by anything. There are no phones and other things, you know, that are distracting us constantly. At least myself, I don't like to take my phone into a mosque. So we are in a completely peaceful environment. We have no other focus except on the prayer. So it's a very calming experience. And in fact, even from a worldly perspective, you have left your stresses of life for a few minutes to be in that mosque. And even if you are offering the prayer at home, those 10 minutes away from everything are a time of calm and you know, you are away from a lot of different kinds of stress. Okay, so the pleasures are there. You have to think about this a little more deeply. That's all I could say for now, but it is an interesting question. There is actually, just before I go to the next and last question, there is a book that I had a chance to write some time ago. One of the questions we addressed in that book is, why is the religion of Islam so boring? Right, or something like that, restrictive, right? So it's The Quest of a Curious Muslim. That is the name of the book. And it's the question number 16, right? So have a read into this. And I believe I quoted Hazrat Khalifatul, so Noah's Ark, read the quotation from there. And Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Rabi Rahimahullah Ta'ala also discusses this topic in one place. I don't see it directly quoted here, but it is part of these discussions, right? So have a read of this and see if that helps you understand this topic better. Okay, so I am running out of time. So I'm going to take this as the last question for today. Does listening to music keep us distant from Allah? You know, music itself cannot be defined good and bad. What is good and bad is our use and consumption of the type and the amount of music that is there. So there's a discussion of this by Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Rabi Rahimahullah Ta'ala on this topic as well. I believe if you just type in music here, it should give you the answer that you're looking for. Yes, there it is, right? So have a read of this answer, but briefly, what is argued there is that there are certain things that are considered laghv in Islam, meaningless and vain pursuits. And if music becomes an obsession, and especially the type of music is vulgar, and a person is spending most of their day just listening to that vulgar music, then it can be harmful, and it can drive a person away from God. So these things, even if we do consume, should be very limited, and we should be very selective, even if we are consuming, that music does not have any negative impact on us or our time that could be better spent elsewhere. All right? Jazakumullah, that's all the time I had for today. I really appreciate all the questions and all those people who joined today. I really appreciate it. Jazakumullah. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد وبارك وسلم إنك حميد